Is there a best way to retrieve sperm in men with testis failure? Paul J. Turek, professor and endowed chair in education, departments of urology, obstetrics and gynecology, and reproductive sciences, University of California, San Francisco School of Medicine, investigates.
So I'm talking about men with no sperm counts and genetic causes of infertility, and all of a sudden, because of technology, they have a chance at conceiving because of IVF and ICSI, and it's become a revolution. It's reformed our field. It's made fertility possible for men with no sperm in the ejaculate, and that's about 5% of infertile men. On the evaluation, you might find that they're blocked, vasectomy classically, or not blocked. There's no vasectomy and their engine's not running. If they're blocked, they could be repaired potentially. If they're not, then their only option really is this. And this is the group we're going to talk about. One of the issues is that although there's no sperm in the ejaculate, there may be sperm in the testicle. And that's because there's a threshold effect of sperm production over which you spill into the ejaculate and under which you don't. So there's absorption in the system. And the question is, who has it? Who doesn't? The Belgian group looked at a pile of patients with different pathologies based on biopsy, and found that you could recover sperm from most of these patients who are normal or have just what's called hypospermatogenesis. But when you got into these categories, roughly about half the time you'll find sperm. And interestingly, I guess it was a good study because it's held up today. It's about half the men with abnormalities, non-obstructed vasospermia, will find sperm in by some or another method. So that's an important take-home point. So why is it important to know if there's sperm there? Because IVF is emotionally expensive and financially expensive. It can minimize damage to the testis. So I don't know if these guys know this, but you know, they'll do anything to have a kid. And some people get 4 or 5 operations and they end up getting testicular failure for hypogonadism. So you can kill a testicle doing this. And then they've got 60 more years on this earth with some kind of testosterone replacement. And maybe other growth factors we don't know about. So I respect that. I said, this is what you want now, but in 10 years it may be different. And I've participated in a lot of these issues. So one question is, can we predict if there's sperm in these men with non-obstructive vasospermia? And so far I would say no. Size of the testicle in one study of cryptorchid men was predictive, 8.4 versus 6.3, but those are all both low, and it wasn't that much different. Testicular size is okay, but not great. So there's nothing absolute. History of ejaculated sperms, called virtual azoospermia, might be helpful. But in diabetics, for instance, they may have normal ejaculates and 5 years later have nothing and have Sertoli cell only. So there can be regression of germline of stem cells in the testis, especially in genetic infertility and with diabetics or systemic disease. FSH levels don't help. Inhibin levels are a little better, but with ROC curves, ROC curves, they're not really formally predictive. And probably the best is the testis biopsy. So it still has value in these men to biopsy their testicle. I'll give you some of the data, but that's probably the best single predictor of whether they're going to have sperm or not. At least you can put a number to that chance if you have a biopsy. So I'd still encourage urologists dealing with these men to do a testis biopsy. If the testicles are asymmetric, I would biopsy both sides. If the testicles are symmetric, I would biopsy the bigger one. And with the biopsy, what you get are certain patterns. So normal is there's a progression of these stem cells to the middle where they become sperm nuclei. Hypospermia is just simply a thinning of this area, so the same progression is occurring in a thinner epithelium. Maturation arrest is very interesting to me because we found a lot of genetic issues in these men. They tend to have germline stem cells, but they don't progress. They stop at meiosis and they lurch to a halt like a wrench was thrown in the testicle. Half of these men have recombination errors. They have problems with meiosis and the system is saying, no go, shut down, not good, bad for the species. Sertoli cell only is where there's no germ cells present, and that's a really hard one to treat. There's some data in mice that you might be able to actually take bone marrow stem cells, so you get a bone marrow biopsy, and throw it in the testicle, and there's a debate in the literature whether you convert bone marrow stem cells to germline stem cells. So it may be an auto transplant. We're working on a lot of stem cell biology right now to try to figure out if we can do that. But embryonic stem cells are potential. So this is a stem cell issue that you need to put them in there. The only problem with biopsies is they only tell us about the biopsied area, and it's pretty invasive. So how about elsewhere? You do prostate biopsies, you know how it goes. Some of the prostate is cancer, the other parts don't. This is the same thing in the testicle, and that's in fact where I got some of my information. And there is a sampling error when you go in these testicles. If you do one biopsy, there's a 30% chance. If you do a couple of sticks with something, you might find more. And if you do a map like I do, it might be 50. So, you know, at some point this curve will flatten out, and we don't know what that number is. But I'm up to 30, on some men. But, you know, I think it will flatten out. So what do we do for these men? There's three basic approaches. One is to take them, put them under local anesthesia or sedation or general, do diagnostic and therapeutic biopsies. So send some to pathology, send some to an IVF lab or an andrology lab, and you're done. If he has sperm, they go to IVF. If there's no sperm, then they should adopt or do donor sperm insemination or live child-free. So that's one option up front, so they don't get involved with IVF ahead of time and lose it. Another one is to do real-time multiple biopsy techniques or a large biopsy like a microdissection, which is popularized by Schlegel at Cornell, with or without a diagnostic biopsy. Just say, look, we're going to go in, there's a 50% chance we'll find sperm, pay for IVF, and have some donor sperm backup, or freeze the eggs if you don't have a sperm, or do it ahead of time and just cancel the IVF cycle. So that's another method. And then I've done all these, but what I like is to do something ahead of time to let men know if there's sperm there. And that's called mapping. Now, just to let you know, the Cochrane database has nice systematic reviews of a lot of things, meta-analyses of a lot of issues in medicine. And they've tackled this one, and they've basically said there's no randomized trial. Systematic reviews are weak, but based on the two or three that have been done and analyzed appropriately, there's no better way to do this than any other. There's insufficient data to suggest any of these procedures is better than any other, which to me means for you, do whatever works for you if you're going to tackle this problem. But the two kind of leading techie sort of things are to do this mapping technique or doing a microdissection, which is a large incision in the testis where you take a microscope and look at seminiferous tubules. And so these are the two I'm going to talk a little bit about and give you the data. So one is to do it in the office, local anesthesia, 30 minutes, you find sperm, yes. They can go to IVF and ICSI, you can direct the biopsy to the area that showed sperm on the map, and that is highly successful. So this might be 50% and this might be 95% in the average case. If it's no, I have said, I'm sorry, I can't help you. I think there's probably a 5% chance that the negatives are not true negatives, but we need to look at that. I've encouraged patients to call me from all over the world or the doctors if they find sperm when I haven't. Hasn't happened yet. I'm waiting. Microdissection is the other one. You do it in the operating room. At the time of IVF and ICSI, you find sperm, yes, they get pregnant. That's about a 60% chance of finding it in the best hands. And if they don't, then they go to another option. Unfortunately, you don't need donor sperm to be used with IVF, so that's a large waste of money. And adoption, you don't need IVF with that either. So I think that's a big cost to do up front. But patients are very different. A microdissection is a concept that's based on cells that have normal spermatogenesis. Seminiferous tubules will be fat. Seminiferous tubules that have Sertoli cells only will be thin. And the difference is between sort of my pinky and my ring finger or whatever. There's a difference, and you can see that under a microscope. It's probably not measurable. But they're thicker and they're more opaque. And so instead of being small, they might be fat. And you just pluck that out, and that could have enough sperm for you to use. So you systematically examine the testis, the entire parenchyma, for several hours under microscopy, under anesthesia. I use local, but that's the original description. And that's what Dr. Schlegel decided to do when he was against the wall with these patients. Doc, I've had three biopsies. They all show this. What can you do for me? And that was his response. In his study originally, he retrospectively compared the multi-biopsy approach with this one, and he found that there was 50% improvement in retrieval of sperm and success. I don't know how he defined it. He didn't say it could be one sperm or it could be all sperm. It's a little bit weak. But he took out a lot less tissue doing it, so he thought it might be less invasive, which is good, although it looks more invasive.
The program continues.
And he then, in another study that followed that, 100 men had identical bilateral histology, so they had biopsies. So one side received a multi-biopsy and one side received a microdissection, so it's an internal control. I can give you data showing that they're probably not identical. But in that situation, again, 50% increase with microdissection, but it wasn't near the 60%. And this is kind of what the world does, around 45, and again, less tissue. So confirm the concept, but not the raw data. And if you look at the overall data now, basically it's still about 50% better than just doing multiple biopsies, but it is a lot more involved. And that's looking at 400, 500, 600 patients now from several institutions. And there's about a 50% chance that these men with failing testicles will have sperm, 50-50. We've learned some other things from people who have done this. If you have a genetic problem with the Y chromosome in the C region of the long arm, which is becoming popular to test for, 75% of the men will have sperm. If you have a deletion in the A or B region, a different part of the Y chromosome, no men have sperm, I think it's too early to say that it's truly zero. It's only based on probably 30 to 40 patients. If a man has cryptorchidism, very good chance they're going to have sperm. So I'm telling the PD guys, if you can pex the testicle as opposed to taking it out, do it, because there's a chance that's going to have sperm later, especially in bilateral cases. And you're motivated anyway in that situation. So I respect the unattended testicle because it's a good source of sperm. And we have shown in men who have no sperm in their ejaculates, no bank sperm to use, and are zero after chemotherapy for various cancers, there's a good chance there's sperm in those testicles too. So those are the subgroups that we have defined, and the rates are pretty impressive except for the genetic guys, the A's and B's. And obviously if there's a man with XX sex reversal who has no Y chromosome or only has the SRY gene and he doesn't have the long arm of the Y where these genes are located, it's unlikely, and I will generally not offer it to them. And in the cryptorchidism paper, they looked at their ability to find in bilateral cryptorchid sperm, which is a tough case because 2/3 of these guys are azoospermic and their testicles have been operated on once and they're in different locations and they have different anatomies. And they found the larger the testicle, the better. FSH made no difference. Testis volume did. And whether the orchidopexy was performed below 10 years of age or above mattered. So that's important for counseling. It also probably is important how old the man is. So if he gets it done sooner or younger, so a young aged orchidopexy and a young patient is probably the best thing with a larger testicle. So that's what's sort of being carved out of this in the last couple of years. And I think Schlegel probably has 800 cases or so. So with the microdissection, you need a microscope. It's not a very high power at times. You need general anesthesia, but I actually don't use that. You will need expertise, and that comes with experience. You need a great lab. The long-term effects are unclear. Testosterone levels with bilateral cases will fall 3 months or so if you check. They will take about a year to recover. So testosterone level may fall, not to castrate levels, but lower, maybe 300 to 150. And in about 85% of men at a year, they'll be back up to normal. So it is important. I do check them at 3 months and at 6 months. If they're not trending back up, I will put them on replacement for a while or stimulate them somehow. But that's just a recovery from damage. 2% of men will lose their ability to make testosterone and go to castrate levels. That sort of depends on surgical techniques. And there's very little data on whether you can repeat this procedure out there. So the other idea is to map them. I got this idea from prostate biopsies at the VA. It's a great idea. You do a lot of these. So this is a technique done under local anesthesia, and it's a matter of just getting clean slides, and then put them in alcohol like a pap smear, and you're doing this systematically under local anesthesia, and that's your sample. And it's literally just an indicator of what's going on in the area. But you get a small sample in the needle. And this is a classic technique. They use it for retinoblastomas in the eye, for breasts, for any lymph nodes. It's a classic cytologic technique. I tried to concentrate on the hilum, figuring that, you know, if you hit the hilum, maybe it'd be more sperm there. It hasn't ended up being true. And instead of getting a histologic look, you get a cytologic look. So you get the cells spread out on a slide. You can't tell whether there's sperm on a biopsy. You can tell if there's a spermatid. But since you're looking kind of down on a set of buildings, you can't tell how tall they are, really. So you can't see a tail. But here you see tail, so you know it's complete. And with Sertoli only, all you see is Sertoli cells. So the pathologists like this because it's kind of fun for them. They're looking at pap smears all day and they're saying, you know, is that nuclear chromatin disorganized? And I give them one of these and they say, oh, it's a tail. I see a tail. Look, it's a tail. So they like it. And one of my patients said, it's kind of like testicular cartography. And I said, yeah, it is. And you can actually go back and there's a little pockmark. I don't leave numbers on the testicle, but they leave little marks. So you can actually put your map on the wall and say, you know, there's a spot right there. That's where we found it. We're going to go back there. So that's just a biopsy, and you can find sperm and testis tissue. And that really is lab expertise. And this is the World Series non-mapping. So there's our stuff which showed that you get it 45% of the time in some of the earlier series, but 95% of the time you'll get it again. So that's not the same as the other series. And then it's running at around 50% as well. So of the people I've trained, I trained Mariana Cohen in Argentina, and some of these people, it's about the same. So I think whatever you use, if it's good, it's going to be about 50%. You don't need an operating microscope. You can use the local anesthesia. You need to be good at it, and that's a training curve that's pretty easy. It's new for urologists, though. Long-term effects, I haven't seen any 800 cases. This is what I'm up against now. So you do this technique, and you find one site with sperm. And if I try to go in there and get sperm, I can never get it. It's very difficult. Not never, but it is a needle in a haystack. So I actually microdissect those men now and find that spot. And this is how it works. So in a bunch of men who come in, If they're going to go to IVF, we had 150 or whatever, 60 at that point went forward. If they're harder cases, they go to microdissection, we're about 86% successful in getting enough sperm for every egg, because I think that's the only measure of importance, not just one or two. You want enough for every egg so they can have a retrieval, they can freeze some eggs, maybe have a family. And if the easier cases with two or more sites, it's 99% basically out of these guys. You rarely miss. And if you miss here, you just go to microdissection. Is it repeatable? Well, I've done it up to 5 times in men. And what's nice about a map is if there's a spot, you go to it and then you're done. You leave the rest there. And if you go on multiple procedures, these guys can have, you just use your map and you can use second site to get sperm the next time or a third site. And so it is quite repeatable. And that's the problem with the technology. It's not perfect. And it only works a third of the time or 40% of the time. So these patients will be knocking again and you have the same problem again all over again. Are there spots that are richer? Where are they found? Is there any correlation between sides or certain histologies more likely? I did maps where I took all left testicles and just piled them up and looked down on them, and I didn't see, there was no site that was any different from hundreds of men if you look at areas of the testicle. If you compare it to a biopsy, about almost 30% of those men who have a biopsy with no sperm will have sperm on mapping. There's variability within testicles in 1 out of 4 men. There's variability between testicles. So it's kind of like a prostate. It's kind of like apples on a tree. If you look at histologies, you know, if they're normal, everyone has sperm. If they're low production but thin but still making it, all of those guys have sperm. Late maturation rest, all of them have sperm. Mixed pathologies, a lot, but these guys are tougher. And that's lower than a lot of other series. So I wondered, is it because the technique's not that good? But, you know, I'm higher in every other pathology except these. And I think it's my patient cohort. It's a well-defined patient cohort. And these are the genetically infertile men. That's why I started looking at these guys for genetics, because there's so few sperm in them. But what I've done is cranked up the technology and sampled higher now in these guys because they're harder to find. I don't know whether that's having any effect. But it's also an archival tool. You can tell what else is present in the testicle. So if a guy is a candidate for in vitro maturation of sperm, if we can take his testicle out and take his early germ cells and put pluripotency genes in them and grow them up and put them back, we could tell him he's in a database. You can find other pathology, lymphomas, whatever. It's kind of pretty versatile. You can phenotype patients better. You can replace the biopsy. I just haven't seen cancer in these men. They're supposed to be higher CIS, the testis in these infertile men with small testicles. I just haven't seen it. I look at all the biopsies. I review hundreds from outside institutions. So I talked with Peter Carroll and I said, should I be doing this? He said, what's your rate of finding testis cancer? And I said, I've never seen it. He said, stop it. It's just not happening. Of course, we don't live in Denmark, where it's a very different story. But what's really new? This is really exciting me. Imagine taking an MRI of a man and getting his testicle and taking a metabolic image of that testicle with the classic NMR that you learned in college biology. And you get a scan of all the substances in that testicle. Well, we've done this in fertile men and in azoospermic men. We take their biopsies. We send it to Mission Bay. And I've been thinking about this for 15 years. But what we find in fertile men is they have a lot of building blocks, phosphocholine, phosphatidylcholine, for constructing sperm. And azoospermic men do not have this spike. In fact, it was revealed to me that this difference in biology between two organs is the largest difference they've seen in metabolic imaging, including cancers and normals. So they wanted to go straight to an abstract. I said, I don't even know what we have here, but think of it like this. If you have a plot of land and you're building a house, what do you do first? You put the lumber there. So if you see lumber in a plot, that's the sign that something's being built. And that's a sign of activity. So in our initial study, when we did these biopsies with normal men, we find that these ratios of phosphatidylcholine are very high and the azoospermic men are very low. And you can actually take a biopsy, give it to an ultrasound physicist, and you can tell whether they're normal or Sertoli only, no germ cells. That can you can differentiate. So you don't need a biopsy for that anymore. You can put it in an imager. And if they're maturation rest, that's a little more of a biological different area. It's harder. But the goal of this is to take a metabolic fingerprint of the testicle, and you can sample this not 30 times or 15, but 100, and take all these little pixels and ask, you know, what's the ratio here and here? And you could find pockets of sperm without touching a patient, and they would really like that. So that's where we're going. It's a tough nut to crack, these failing testicles. There's no standard approach. Biopsies are still valuable. There's biology to be learned, and doing it well is being kind to the rest of your team, and also being kind to your patients.